So there is the sub, the matter has to be there, and that is what will get you the, let's say, marks.
But these diagrams and all are in the are in this study material, right?
It should be there. Even if it is not there in the study material, it's something that you should be aware of. Okay. Anything else apart from the book size? That is it. ICD and CFSS, you were mentioning. CFS and ICD. What do you think is the, in your understanding, is a CFS and an ICD? Excellent.
So ICD is obviously it's inland. So there's like some train network or something that takes it from the shore port to the inland. And one is more for storing or warehousing containers, and one is more for stuffing, destuffing, and doing everything. And one is bigger and one is smaller.
Okay.
Yes. CFS is smaller material.
When you say bigger and smaller.
In size, in square meters.
Bigger and smaller, and then you are saying square meters.
ICDs, they have machinery that can move around everywhere inside the ICD because it's like there's more space.
Yes.
But in the CFS is mostly, it's always, that means it's more or less the same thing, but they have slightly different functions. Like one would be more just for clearing customs or
doing
customs formalities.
Okay. CFS are outside the
port area and away from the premises, and inland container depots are inside the port premises.
Both, more or less, both have the same work.
More or less, both have the
same
work.
Documentation processes.
Okay. Go on, go on. I'd like to hear more from your side. Please. Everybody can answer this question. I find a gap in terms of the understanding of the CFSS and ICD. Though you know, you have the peripheral knowledge, but somewhere, like he used a word, one is bigger and the other one is smaller. It's a very relative or a generalized term that you are using, big and small. Okay? There is a specification that is there. As far as the government requirements are concerned, when you are setting up an ICD or a CFS, this is very important that you need to know when you are talking about any ICD or CFS, because tomorrow you could be a part of the entire operations or feasibility study aspect of it when you are talking about getting into the business of CFS and ICD. Very, very important. In simple words, when we talk about CFSs and ICD, you said very correctly, CFS and ICD is, ICD is the one which you mentioned that it existing in the inlands. Perfect. Example of that? Perfect. In Delhi, somewhere in Delhi, let's say. You have lots of ICDs in Delhi, inland container depots. Remember, it is nothing but it is an off-dock facility. That means the terminals are a custom notified area. The terminals for export and import are a custom notified area. This is nothing but an off-dock facility. Today, when you have to travel abroad, you go to the airport and you check in your baggage, right? The baggage that you check in at the airport. Not necessarily all the time you have to go to the airport. There could be collection counters. I think in Delhi they have started this, if I am not mistaken. In Hong Kong is when I remember, about 10 to 15 years back, still I remember, in Hong Kong, right at the city center, okay, in the central station, you can check in your baggage. You don't need to roam around with your baggage every time. Because the moment you land in Hong Kong, you get a visa on arrival for 14 days. There is no other formalities that are there. Only thing is, you should not be blacklisted into that country. So long as you are not blacklisted, you will get a visa on arrival. The moment you get a visa on arrival, there are a lot of people who keep traveling here and there. You can actually check in your baggage for the next flight, let's say, after 5 hours, at the center of the city itself. So, if you are there, if you have come for a meeting or something of that sort and you are going the next day, in the morning when you check out of the hotel, the flight might be in the evening, you don't need to roam around with your baggage. You take your baggage, go to the city center, you can check in your baggage in the center of the city. What is it happening? These baggages are going by shuttle trains to the airport, where the flight is actually there. Similar is the case as far as ICDs are concerned. ICDs are nothing but the gateway ports are over here in India. These are the gateway ports, and ICDs are, let's say, located in the inlands. They are also custom bonded area. Means it is bound by the custom rules and regulations. You cannot get anything inside without the authority of the customs. At the same time, you cannot take anything outside without the authority of the customs. That is what is a inland container depot. It is nothing but, it is also sometimes referred to as a dry port. It is an off dock, means away from the docks facility, under the custom jurisdiction. Same is the case as far as CFSs are also concerned. Container freight station. The container freight station also has a similar kind of a role to play. There are, however, minute differences that are there. What are those? We will see now. ICDs and CFS, very important to understand. A common user facility with public authority status, equipped with fixed installations. Read the words carefully. With fixed installations and offering services for handling and temporary storage of export and the import cargo, laden and empty containers carried under customs control. It's bonded area. It is under the control of the customs. Very important. And with customs and other agency, competent agencies to clear the goods for home use, warehousing, temporary admissions, re-export, temporary, let's say, storage for onward transit and outright export. All these activities, the people are present over there and it is coming under their jurisdiction. Who are the people? Customs. So, they need to be present also over there. It is not just about an area which is under the control of customs. No, you need to have a designated area for the representative of this authority as well. It is not just an area which is bound, or let's say, under the customs jurisdiction. That is very, very important to understand. Transshipment of cargo can also take place from such stations. There is a transshipment activity which is also taking place. Remember, these are all Exim cargoes which we are talking about over here. The terminals are, let's say, under the customs jurisdiction. off-dock facilities which are a part of the terminal. It is an off the dock, that's all. Whatever can go on inside the terminal today, because of the restrictions in terms of space availability, they are actually taken off the dock. That is all it is. Whether it is 3000 kilometers away from the port or it is just 3 kilometers away from the port, they are under the customs jurisdiction. Yes, please. Transshipment port nahi. Kya, what did?
Transshipment of cargo.
Yes.
Can they do it in ICD? Do they do it in ICD?
Yes, sure. They do it in the ICD. When you use the word transshipment of cargo, can also take place from such stations. When you say transshipment, what does it mean? Not necessary from one ship to the other ship. One mode, let's say, or one shipment, one roll of shipment or one leg of shipment which takes place. There is a break over there and then the next leg starts from there. That is what is called as a transshipment. Okay, it's not nothing to do with, it has to be on the ship. Shipping, when we say ship it out, doesn't mean that you have to put it on a ship only. It is shipping, that means it can be sent by air as well. It can be sent by road as well. Okay. When we use the word dispatch, basically it is shipping, dispatching it or shipping the goods, shipping the mail, dispatching the mail. That is where we use. So transshipment of cargo can also take place. Means if it has to go to, let's say, a door delivery in Delhi, okay, in Nehru Place, where does it first go and settle? It will go to ICD Dadri, and from ICD Dadri, it is under custom bond. Remember, it is under the seal. Papers are cleared and then it is going into the door of Nehru Place. Transshipment is taking place over there. If it's coming to India, let's say go a little bit more, zoom out of the map, come little outside. Now when you see, where is it coming? It is coming to Colombo. And from Colombo, it will be transshipped into another, let's say, transport leg, and that is any vessel which is coming, let's say cargo coming from China, comes to Colombo, it is transshipped and then it will go into Cochin. Transshipped, not necessarily on a ship. It comes into Kolkata, it is transshipped in Kolkata, whatever mode of transport it can be, and then it goes into Nepal by road, transshipped. So it can be transshipped into a road, let's say truck. It can be transshipped into a rail, it can be transshipped into a barge, it can be transshipped into a feeder vessel, whichever mode of transport it is. Fine? This is how a photograph of how a ICD looks like. Generally, CFSs, except for three of them, in the port of Nhava Sheva, as far as the knowledge that I have as of today, only three container freight stations have got a rail siding inside them. The rest of the other 40 plus CFSs in and around the port of Nhava Sheva does not have a rail siding. So we assume this should be an ICD which is there. Containers are all arranged as per the. So this is a sort of CY, if I may say so. How you have a container yard inside the port and the quay where the containers are loaded and discharged. Here you have a container yard and then you have the rail heads which are coming inside the ICDs where the containers are offloaded and loaded. There the ships come where the containers get loaded and offloaded. Here the rail let us say comes where the containers get offloaded and loaded. Of course, the railhead is there, and then you have a gate over here through which you will have the containers going out and the containers coming in by road movements. This is how typically an ICD looks like. Can come in various forms. Can come in various forms. Apart from the ICD, since you have the container freight station, which is located closer to the port premises, you will see over there in an IC, in a CFS, you will have, normally you won't have the rail head or the rail connections. You will have more of the road connections. That's why you will see the number of trucks that you can see in this one is much, much higher in relation to the ones which we saw in the previous slide. So this is how a CFS looks like. That is a container freight station. Remember, whether it is an ICD or it is a CFS, it is a custom notified area. You will have a UN locator code for this place as well. That brings to my next question. What is UN locator code? Because I could see some eyes at that time opening up, giving some expressions. What is a UN locator code? Fine. What is the UN locator for?
Based on a container, something
like that. GPS, where it tracks.
There is a chip placed on the container.
Chip, no. UN locator code. I am talking about a code. I am not talking about a locating device or something, tracking device. No. I am talking about a UN locator code. When you travel by air, for example, to Delhi, okay, my favorite place. When you travel to Delhi by air or to Dubai by air, have you seen the strip of paper which they stick on your bag to identify where the bag has to go? There is a barcode as well on that. But there is something else written on that. What is written on that? Not necessary numeric. Ye thoda zyada ho gaya. Not necessary numeric. There is an alpha code that is there. Is it written DEL over there for Delhi?
Yes.
Is it written DXB for Dubai?
Yes.
Yes. For Mumbai, it is written BOM, bomb. Right? When you are coming back to Mumbai, you can see your bag with bomb written on that. What is it? Similar is the case, the moment you talk about, let's say, Mumbai or Navasheva, you will have something which is called as IN, that is, the first two letters indicates the country and the second three letters indicates the depot or the terminal where this cargo is destined for. So, INNSA is India, Navasheva. If you talk about SAJED, we regularly do this in a day-to-day basis in our work. We need to know what are these. These are called as UN locator codes. Fine? It's very important to keep this into track, because you cannot spell out a name, okay, and write the names. You will always go wrong. We know in our own companies we have examples where people call up and ask, do you have a service for Victoria? And the person on the other side replies, no, we don't have a service for Victoria. The person who has asked for a destination of Victoria. The person who has replied has said that I don't have a service to Victoria. Victoria is in Seychelles. Victoria is in, one is in Indian Ocean, the other was in the Atlantic Ocean. See the difference? On one side you have a person asking for, do you have service for Legon? You say, sorry, we don't serve Legon. Do you have service for Livorno? Yes, we have service for Livorno. Ah, okay. Do you have service for Napoli? No, we don't have service for Napoli. Do you have service for Naples? Yes, we have service for Naples. Do you have service for, most important, Bombay? No, we don't have service. We don't know what Bombay is. We only know. Of course, this has to be flipped the other way around. Very, very important. However, the UN locator code, okay, is something that doesn't change. That is the reason why still today the UN locator codes of Bombay has not become Mumbai. Still you will find in the aviation industry it is written as BOM. Okay, don't go and inform this to any parties, otherwise we will have a problem. We will have to change that also. Okay. United Nations. IMO number, UN number. It's all distinctive numbers which is given on a global scale. In an IMDG code you have a UN number which is given to a hazardous cargo. Same is the case as far as a UN locator code. That means this is something which is followed on a global scale by all the companies which are engaged in the transportation chain. They cannot change these formats. That is the reason why when you say Mangalore, for example, what is the first thing that will come to your mind? What would be Mangalore's UN locator code? MAN, MLR. Yeah, but at least starting from M, isn't it? But what is it? It is INIXE. Mangalore is INIXE. Because there might be a lot of places in the world, remember, which has got the locator codes, let's say, opened up. So you cannot have MLR, it can stand for some other place, Mahabalipuram maybe, for all you know. So all these things need to be taken into consideration. So it's not so, but the moment you say INIXE, you know this has to go to this specific place only. Today there is a lot of discussion which is going on regarding the choice of CFS as to whether my cargo should go to that CFS or this CFS. Remember, each and every CFS has got a UN locator code. Book the cargo if you want to that destination, directly to that specific CFS. No problems at all. Provided you are ready to bear the cost for that. Because it is a custom and, let's say, recognized destination. So, just to update you, CFS and ICDs all have got a UN locator code, which is very, very important. Okay.
So what is the basic difference? I mean, what is the basic difference
between an ICD and a CFS? We're coming to it. We just wanted to start off. We need to understand the basics first, and then we will understand what are the basic differences. Functions. Because these are all common. So whatever is common is what I am trying to show you first. And then we will try to identify how a CFS becomes an ICD. The only common thing over there is the character C. Fine? Container. That is the common one in both of them. Fine? Functions. What all they do? They are involved in the receipt and dispatch / delivery of cargo. Stuffing and stripping of containers. Okay, stuffing of the containers and stripping of the or de-stuffing of the containers. Transit operations, transshipment you can say, operations by railroad to and from the serving ports that are being done. Custom clearance, most important, whether it is exports or imports, both the custom clearances are done over here. Consolidation and desegregation of LCL cargo. What is LCL cargo? Less than container load cargo. Temporary storage of cargo and containers can also be undertaken in these areas. Reworking of containers. If any cargo has been stuffed and the surveyor who has come to inspect that container says, sorry, this container has been not stuffed properly as per the requirements. In that case, the reworking of the container can also be done because it is a custom bonded area. You can break the seal, you can restuff the containers and put the new seal back in place under the custom supervision. You cannot just do it anywhere outside, won't be allowed. Maintenance and repair of container units, provided the MNR facilities are there within the premises of the CFS or the ICD. Sometimes you will have a separate area which is allocated for the MNR, maintenance and repair of all the containers. Okay. Operation of ICDs and CFS. Coming back to your question, what is it that differentiates them? These are what differentiates them generally. Most important for an ICD operationally, what are the requirements that are there? 6000 TEUs per year. Two-way. Exim, let's say, if we can use the word. However, for the CFSs, the requirements are around 1000 TEUs, okay, exim. Land requirement for a CFS is how much? 1 hectare. For an ICD, it is 4. These are the requirements. Before you can set up, you cannot have an ICD with just 2 acres, let's say, of land. It has to be 4. Apart from the rail siding, in case of a rail based terminal where ICDs are concerned, ICDs need not be that it should have a rail. No. ICDs, there are a lot of ICDs which are just as a road connecting ICD. Okay, there are a lot of ICDs. Pithampur, for example, in Indore is just a rail ICD. Chinchwad, if I am not mistaken, in Pune is also a road ICD. You don't have, let's say, KSH Distri Park, a private player in Talegaon is also a road ICD. It is not, it doesn't have a rail connection at all. Okay. Container yard has to be there, there has to be a warehouse, and most important, there has to be a gate complex. It has to be a gated area. It has to be a controlled area. You cannot have open, let's say, acre of land which is there. It has to be a complex. Fine? Security systems have to be there in that thing. So these are the main, let's say, important things that is there as far as. So if you ask me, for example, what is the main difference? The most important is the area that is required to set up an ICD, whereas as compared to a CFS. A CFS would be at 1 as compared to an ICD which is at 4. The throughput, okay, in terms of the exim volumes that they handle would be 6000 as compared to 1000 for a CFS. Generally, the CFS are located closer to the port area. ICDs as a principles are normally located far away inlands into the away from the port area. ICDs are generally connected by rail / road. CFSs are mostly connected by road, but exceptions are also there where the rail connectivity is as well available. Okay. This is how we would put it as far as the ICDs and the CFSs are concerned. Sorry, tell me.
Very quickly, sir. You said that normally ICDs will be inland. So it happens that ICDs are more towards the port also?
You have exceptions of ICDs which could be established near the port locations as well. It is an inland container depot. Now, inland, again, there is no distance which is established that, okay, within 50 kilometers, let's say radius, it will be an CFS and it will not be an ICD. Nobody states that. Okay, you have halfway to Pune, you have let's say CFS which has been established, and in Pune you have a ICD which is established. So it all depends on the nomenclature, but most important what you see, the last two points, that is what differentiates, or let's say the last four bullet points is what differentiates in terms of the requirements that are there from an ICD and a CFS. Both. They are custom bonded areas in both ICDs and CFSs. Custom, it is controlled by the customs. There is a separate office which has to be provided with air condition, let's say, as far as the office of the commissioner, let's say assistant commissioner of customs, or the AC, what we call it, he has to sit over there. Adequate arrangements needs to be made over there for him to be seated there. Fine. So what are the benefits, if I may say so, benefits of a ICD and a CFS? Concentration points for export cargo and its unitization. Okay, concentration points for export cargoes and its unitization. The reason why we are saying the word unitization is because you could have cases where bagged rice in, let's say, bagged form comes from the mandis which are there, or soya in loose form, okay, comes in trucks and it is unitized over there in the ICD or in the CFSs. So it comes into the warehouse and it is actually offloaded into the warehouse. From the warehouse, each and every, they can have machineries installed in the warehouse where the bagging of the cargo takes place. The bagging of the cargo takes place. What we are talking about? Concentration points for export cargo and its unitization. So you can have loose cargo being put into bags. At the same time, you have multiple bags put on pallets and which can be also cling wrapped. Very, very important that is there. Service as a transit facility. It can be used as a transfer facility. Okay. Custom clearance facility available near the center of production and consumption. Custom clearance facility available near the center of production and consumption. What do you mean by this? What do you mean by that word? Custom clearance facility available near the center of production and consumption.
Near the factories.
Exactly. The factories which produces the raw material, for example, correction. The factories which produces the raw material, that is where the customs are available. So for exports, it is available over there where the production takes place. At the same time, you have the white goods which comes, all the electronics which comes from the Far East, from Japan, from China, from Korea, from Malaysia into India, let's say. The consumption takes place also in that area. The customs are placed, or the facilities are available closer to that specific area. Reduced level of demurrage and pilferage. Okay, reduced level of demurrage and pilferage that is there. No customs required at the gateway ports. Once it is custom cleared at the ICD, then you do not need again any further checks by customs at the gateway ports. Issuance of a through bill of lading by shipping lines, thereby assuming full liability of the shipments. Okay. Reduced overall level of empty container movement. Reduced overall level of empty container movement is the most important thing, because in the earlier days you had cargo which used to come in as imports coming to the port. The truck takes the container, empties the cargo, okay, and then takes it. Or in most of the cases, they take the entire container along with them and then go to the factory, destuff it, and then get the empty container back. If there was NICD in that specific area, there is a strong possibility that the box could be dropped off over there rather than coming back empty. On the laden side, what happens? Empty is going all the way from the port to the respective factory area. Take an example of the Vapi area in South Gujarat. From Nawasheva port, you can see, when you are on the highway, you can see clearly all the trucks that goes with maximum speed are the ones which are empty. They freak out when they are empty. What is there? They are actually going empty for stuffing of the cargo. You have laden containers going as imports, at the same time you have empty containers going as empties for exports requirement. On the other lane, when you are coming back, you will see export laden containers going towards the port, at the same time empty containers also going towards the port which has been destuffed. Though we have an ICD in and around the Vapi area, but it is not used in a very big way. But if you had a very big facility in that specific area, what would happen? The containers which are going in for import, let's say, to the factory, after discharging in the factory, the container can be offloaded into that ICD. The truck can pick up another container which is stuffed over there in that specific premises, and it can bring that stuffed container back. So both ways you will see its laden container movement and reduced overall level of empty container movement. I hope everybody has understood what I am saying. Yes? So these are the benefits of NICD and CFS. Competitive transport cost. The moment the transporter gets, let's say, laden, okay, both ways, that is not a problem. Otherwise, what do you call it in the normal taxi, let's say, thing? Return bhada, we call it. What is this return bhada funda? This is what it is. Okay. At the same time, reduced inventory, let's say, cost, which is there. The moment we talk about reduced inventory cost, it is mainly for the lines that is there. Increased trade flows. For all these reasons which were there, if it is beneficial for any, let's say, exporter, we will see more and more trade flows, let's say, taking place. But it is not about just the area or the space that is available. It is not about the exim movements or anything. When we speak about area and space available and exim movement, most important, whether we will be able to have the cargo flow in that specific area as required is the biggest question mark. Reduced level of demurrage, for example, the cargo arrives at Nawasheva. Okay? The cargo arrives at Nawasheva. Your final destination, when you book a cargo to Nawasheva, okay, the cargo has arrived over here on the 1st of November. Your bill of lading states FPOD as IN Dadri, let's say. When it is going to Dadri as FPOD, it will take, let's assume a case because of congestion and everything, it is taking about 10 days. It's reached on the 10th of November. Your demurrage, let's say. Yeah, your demurrage starts when? On the 10th of November. Fine. The other case, it comes on the 1st of November. Due to the congestion and port issues and all those things, you will not be able to take the delivery of the cargo over here because the cargo is still stuck inside the port. Assuming. What happens? After that, you take the cargo out and then you take the container all the way across to your factory. And then you have to return it back. You have to travel a distance. At the same time, you are plagued with the congestion issues and everything. Most of the time, you go and you come back, you will end up with 15th November. What is the days that you get? 10 days, let's say. And here you have got 5 days. You have done 5 days more in terms of your demurrage. You will have to pay for that, or what we call it as a detention in the local language. Detention lag gaya, detention lag gaya. This is what we are talking about. Whereas here your factory, remember, is located only over here. Your factory is located only here, close, just 2 kilometers from the ICD. On the 10th, it is discharged at the ICD. You are not bothered. When you take it on the 10th, you take it to your factory, discharge the cargo, come back, and you are offloading the box straight into the ICD. Your exposure in terms of taking the box across the countryside and all those things is not there at all. How much time would it take? 1 day? 2 days? 3 days for a distance of 10, 15, 20, 100 kilometers? So, 10th, you clear the cargo, you have actually finished destuffing the cargo, let's say, and returning the container by the 13th. How many days you have taken?
3 more days.
Only 3 days. Only 3 days. Because your clock or your meter starts on the 10th of November. The person who takes the delivery here, his meter starts on the 1st of November. Final port of delivery. On the bill of lading, you have how many cells? 4. You have port of origin, port of loading, port of discharge, and final port of delivery or final port of destination. So your cargo could come from Delhi. Port of loading will be Nhava Sheva or Mundra, and then your POD would be Felixstowe, and your cargo would be going to Birmingham. Yes, where you want the cargo to be finally booked. Fine. Coming back to the next point, what you raised was demurrage and pilferage. Remember, if the FPOD is there as, let's say, Birmingham or as Dadri, this entire transportation, let's say, leg which is there, you are not bothered. You are bothered when the container arrives over here. You are not taking the delivery here. You are actually exposed. A lot of people are there who get exposed to the pilferage problem which is there. Nowadays that is quite a lot. Pilferage is quite a lot as far as the containerized cargo, because everybody knows that containerized cargo is relatively expensive. You have generally finished goods which are moving in containerized cargo, especially when it coming in imports. And they keep a proper track of what is what. You will see sometimes even the food grains when it is going towards the Washi market, there are those small boys, I don't know how many of you have seen it, at the signal, yeah, or at the various dhabas that are there, small, small kids, they go and they poke the bags and they collect chemicals, specialty chemicals, which are actually sold at 70 rupees, 200 rupees a kg. All these, nowadays even tur dal is also at 200 rupees a kg, so I don't want to comment on that. But they just poke the bag with a knife, okay, and they collect. And they immediately collect this and they go and they sell it outside. Doesn't make a difference for them. But at the end of the day, there is a pilferage which has taken place. There will be a short landing at the destination. Same is the case over here. There are a lot of industries, for example, which manufacture these wires, yeah, for the electrical wires. Hum log hamesha bolte hai na, copper, original copper wire. Of course, you have aluminium, copper, everything mixed into it. Now, for manufacturing these wires, where does this copper come from? To manufacture these wires, where does aluminium come from? To manufacture the steel coils and then coat it, where does the galvanized steel, let's say the galvanized form, that is zinc, where does zinc come from? It comes from various parts of the world. It comes from India as well. Hindustan Zinc is one of the biggest manufacturers of zinc, you can say. Copper is, let's say, exported from various places, from the mines in Africa, wherever it is, and aluminium also comes from there. Dubai Aluminium manufactures a hell of a lot of aluminium when it comes into India. All these ingots, when it comes, let's say, the ingots are expensive metal which is there. Expensive metal. These expensive metal, okay, at the end of the day is bound to be stolen. And you will have a lot of these transporters actually deploying security guards along with that. And they track their vehicles as well. They have a GPS kind of installation on the vehicle where they track their vehicle regularly, which is very, very important. You have nowadays even cargo declared, let's say silver comes but is declared as metal bars. Silver declared as metal bars and it arrives over here. This is purely before the Diwali season. Lot of silver is imported in containers as bars. All the kaju katli and all those things, various dishes that we eat, you have a foil on that. You pay 300 rupees, you feel, or 400 rupees or 500 rupees, I think now it's more than 500, you feel you are getting silver. You pay 100 rupees, you feel you are getting aluminium. Yes, that is how it looks. But yes, all this consumption that takes place across India comes from somewhere. And these metals which are there when going in the trucks, it is bound to be, let's say, possibilities of pilferage is there. That is the reason, reduced level of demurrage and pilferage, because it is going under seal. What happens is, they are lot of times when they actually put the container, okay, and have a security guard along with it. When it is loaded on trains, you know what they do? They store the door to door. Even on the ships, cargo which is bound to Africa, for example, we normally store door to door. And if you store door to door, you cannot access the door at all. And normally, I don't think the thieves who are involved in this ever think of lifting a container sideways and then open the door. No way. They don't get into those hassles. Okay? But just to share with you, since you raised the point, how do you feel reduced level of demurrage and pilferage? This is what is an example for reduced level of demurrage and pilferage. Yeah? Like I said, when we speak about ICDs and CFS, we need to always take into consideration the reason why they are existing also. And if you are getting into the business, like I said, a feasibility study, if you have to do regarding an ICD and a CFS, you need to take all this into consideration. Commodities is most important, which you need to take into consideration. What all are the commodities which are coming in and around that area? We also use the word as catchment area or the readily available market. Catchment area is very, very important when you try to set up an ICD. You cannot have a port or an ICD if the catchment area is not clearly defined. The reason why we are telling this is purely because you need to have cargo within the catchment area. At the same time, you will end up sometimes into a fight or a clash with the adjoining ICD because the catchment areas are, let's say, overlapping each other. I hope everybody is understanding. You will have one ICD here, you will have the second ICD here, you will have the third ICD here. The catchment area for this, the catchment area for this, and the catchment area for this are all overlapping. You need to take that into account always. And the commodities which are originating in this area is very, very important. If it's predominantly heavy cargo that is originating in that area, heavy cargo are having some limitations in terms of how they can move by road. We are all aware of that, right? There are certain road limitations which are there. Now, if it's predominantly heavy cargo, then definitely they should look at an option of setting up an ICD with a rail head more than just relying on the road transport. Directional split, imports and exports. You cannot have a one-way traffic. You need to have a two-way traffic always. You cannot afford to have a one-way traffic. Otherwise, you will not be able to survive in the long run. And it goes for any transportation business. Even a taxi driver who operates, he cannot operate always one ways. Otherwise, what is he insisting? Return bhada. Because he wants to make sure that he doesn't go empty in the second leg. Otherwise, he won't survive. So, directional split is very important for imports and exports. The split when we talk about is also important because it's not just the laden cargo out and laden cargo inside, but also the split of 20s and 40s. It cannot be a case where maximum 40 footers are coming in and demand is for 20 footers. How do you get the 20 footers inside? You have to reposition them if that is the case. The ICDs will not be a success story if that imbalance is also there. So it's very important that that is also assisting. Though it is not always the case, most of the locations you will find, because raw material comes predominantly, imports comes in 20 footers and exports goes in 40 footers. Or you have finished goods, white goods, electronics, expensive instruments, garments, which comes inside in 40 footers, and you will have agri-based exports which are going out in 20 footers. That imbalance map will always remain more or less, but it has to be taken into consideration and equalized, you can say, depending on the type of the various commodities. That's why the commodity base is very, very important. Commodity base is very, very important. Proportions of LCLs and FCLs. It has to be adequately balanced, the proportion of the LCLs and the FCLs. There could be, let's say, ICDs and CFSs, which could be heavily dependent on LCLs, where the consolidation are taking place within their premises. And there could be, let's say, CFSs or ICDs which are relying heavily on FCLs. Okay. Forecast of future growth. How many industries would be set up in that area? Future growth. How do you see the future for that specific area is very important. Is a new, let's say, factory going to be set up which will manufacture, let's say, ethyl alcohol? Will there be a new setup which will manufacture new cars? Is Nissan going to set up their new factory over there? All those things have to be taken into consideration. What are the, let's say, projected growth for that specific area, maybe for the next 10 years? You need to take into consideration before you start doing any ICD and CFS setup. Modes of transport which are available. All modes of transport should be tried out. There is no problem in even thinking about having the barge running in the river, which may be closer to the ICD. You should check that out also. Possible reduction in ton per kilometer. Okay? Possible reduction in ton per kilometer that we are talking about. This is very, very important as far as ICDs are concerned. Boxes per kilometer cost. These are all finally ending up at the logistics cost as well as the emission norms that are there. All this reduction in the ton per kilometer or box per kilometer cost. These are all in the cost savings that will count. Coming to the next one, infrastructure at ICDs and CFSs. I hope you have not done this topic before, right? Provision of standard payment for heavy duty equipment for use in operational and stacking area of the terminal. This is a very, very important thing. In India, most of the places when you go, they first have a CFS ready. 4 acre plot, let's say, facility taken, or 1 acre. And then what is told? Okay, out of which half of it, let's say 2 acres facility, is paved area. The remaining is open ground. And depending on the traffic, we will develop it. Even the paved areas, I've seen in lot of ICDs, the paved area actually give way because of the weight of the trailers after some time, where the pavement, or let's say the paved area, you have lot of ups and downs. The container trailers cannot move in a proper pace. You have cases where the mafis have come over there and the mafis have actually toppled because of the, let's say, entire road which is going down. Why is this happening? Yes, please. Mafi is nothing but a trailer which is low in height. It's a specific kind of a trailer which is devised for heavy loads. It has got multiple, let's say, chassis, and the construction of that base or platform is very heavy. It is designed generally as a 20-foot mafi or a 40-foot mafi, and it can carry various types of loads, break bulk, bulk and everything. Not bulk generally, but break bulk and the containerized cargo.
So it loads directly from the ship or?
The mafis are generally, it is nothing but a trailer, let's say. It is nothing but a trailer. Only difference is the trailer is like a truck. The mafis are much lower and they are detachable from the gooseneck. They don't have the similar mechanism of a trailer where they come and they, let's say, join to the hauling unit. There is a specific name for that, not getting it right. There is a specific name where the truck trailer comes and joins the truck. That connection which is there, there is a specific name which can be automatically released or automatically connected as well. In the mafi, you just have the let's say hauling unit which is there, okay, and it just goes and picks up the mafi mechanically and just pulls it out. Of course, as an accidental, let's say, as an accident, it shouldn't be a case where the mafi becomes loose, so it gets added or connected with a chain kind of a device. Otherwise, the gooseneck which is there, it actually has a system wherein the gooseneck of the hauling thing has got a device in this fashion, and this goes inside the mafi and it picks it up in this fashion. It normally never slips out, but however, for safety purposes, you have a chain kind of a system which is there. And the Mafi is nothing but it has got, let's say, wheels, and the height of the Mafi would be just about this much. Of course, in Mafis you have various types. You have high bed Mafis, you have low bed Mafis also. For special and cargo which has got a high center of gravity, you will have low bed Mafis which are used. Cargo with low center of gravity, you will have high bed Mafis which are being used. Fine. Office building for, let's say, ICD, customs office, and a separate block for user agencies equipped with basic facilities. Customs office has to be there. Apart from the customs office, okay, apart from the customs office, you have a separate block for exports and, sorry, you have a separate block, let's say, for user agencies. When we say user agencies, what can you understand from that? Customs has to be there. Who are the user agencies?
CHAs.
Perfect. You will need to have CHAs who are there, who will need to have offices. So apart from the customs, you will have small cubicles which are there, okay, and in these small cubicles you will have the CHAs who are present. They set up their offices for the ease of handling, because for them to take the documents, get it to the customs, get it back, it is a easy way. Warehousing facility separately for exports and imports, and long term storage of bonded cargo. We have discussed this always. Warehousing facility is something which is very important, let's say important, especially when you are talking about consolidation of cargo. If you are talking about the agri volumes which are there, agri volumes comes and gets stuffed over there, and other loose items which also comes to the premises of the ICDs and CFSs. It is warehoused over there first, and from there it is then stuffed into a container. Notebooks, for example, there are a lot of books which are exported from India to Africa. I don't know how many of you know about this. Okay, all these books in which you take the notes. What is that? Sundaram books? Huh? We always see one ad just before April, huh? Navneet books? Classmate nowadays? Huh? Deluxe and non-deluxe? Okay. Anyway, so these are the ones which we need to take into consideration, that these are the books which actually come in trucks from the factories to the CFS where the warehousing is there. So they have taken a space inside the CFS, specific amount of space. Yes, we can now, that space we can calculate in square meters. So it is taken in square meters, the warehousing space, the books are stacked over there, depending on the container and the requirement that is there, the containers are placed, the containers are stuffed, and it is taking, let's say, for exports and imports. If long term storage is required of the bonded cargo, then that is also done over there. It is not just the dry cargo, even the refrigerated cargo also facilities are available, just for your information. Gate complex with separate entry and exit unit, very important. The gate complex is separate with entry and exit units. There is a strict watch which is kept in this area. Adequate parking space for vehicles awaiting entry to the terminal. There has to be adequate parking space available. It shouldn't be a case where all the trucks are just waiting to enter the terminal or the CFS, and they have created a massive jam outside the CFS. It does happen. If you go towards the Panvel area, you will understand what I am talking about, especially when you are going towards the CFS. The entire thing gets jammed, and then you know what you guys do generally. You drive on the, immediately you change yourself, transform yourself as if you are an American citizen. And which side of the road do you drive? On the right hand side of the road. Yeah? boundary wall according to the standards specified by the customs. It is clearly mentioned in as far as the customs are concerned, what is the height, let's say, of the boundary wall that needs to be there. The internal roads for the service and the circulating areas, all those are clearly mentioned. Electronic way bridge. The electronic way bridge is also something that is mentioned. It is also mentioned as far as the custom notification is concerned, which has been issued to all the CFSs and all the terminals. Computerized processing of documents with capability to be linked with EDI. What is EDI?
Interface.
Okay. It is a scripted or it is a coded format, if we may say so. So when you get that file, for example, it will be in a coded format. Unless and until your system is not capable to handle that coded format, it will be garbled for you in your system. So you need to be, let's say, EDI capable. So if you are EDI capable, you receive that data, you upload it, only then you will be able to view it in the format that you want. Otherwise, you will not be able to. All the data that is there, which is exchanged between the terminals and the shipping lines, between the various yards and the shipping line, in terms of what is the, let's say, daily gate in and gate out, which container has gone out, which container has come in, all those details are sent, let's say, or transferred from one place to the other with on the EDI format only. Even the manifest of a vessel goes in a EDI format. It's only the agencies and the HO which has got, let's say, capabilities of downloading the EDI, and they have a format in which it is downloaded, only then they can go through the files. You and me will not be able to download and go through the files. You can download it, but it will be a format which will be of no use to you. Fine. So, these are the infrastructure requirements that are there as far as the ICDs are concerned. Perfect. That is one way of a consortium. The second type of a consortium is also where you have a VSA, Vessel Sharing Agreement, that is also there. Okay. So, when we talk about consortium, like our friend pointed out over here, it is a sort of, what did he say, consolidation of ships, okay, or anything, same thing. When you don't have enough cargo to fill up a container, when you don't have enough cargo to fill up a container, you call it as a consolidation, where 10 metric cube and 10 metric cube comes together, becomes 30 metric cube, and cargo gets stuffed into a 33 metric cube 20 footer, and it is sent from point A to point B. What is the basic for this one? There is not enough inducement or not enough cargo that can move from point A to point B within that specific period of time. So, if you take into consideration the India to, let's say, the Europe trade lane, which is there, what we call it as the east-west, let's say, trade lane, okay, India to Europe. Now, if the cargo volumes are low, there is not enough cargo in the market. If there is a service which is running between India to Europe at 50% capacity, let's say A service, and there is B service which is also running at 50% of its capacity, vessels of A are running up and down, vessels of B are also running up and down. It's the same thing that you do, let's say, for example, when you try to pull in to travel to the office and back. Whenever we see in the Andheri Kurla road nowadays, you will find lot of, let's say, vehicles with a MH05 registered vehicles. Do we know what is MH05 registered vehicles, where it belongs to? It belongs to the Kalyan Dombivli area, let's say. You will find lot of vehicles coming, and every day in the morning when you peep into those vehicles, you will find at least 3 to 4 people occupying that car. And those 4 people can come in one car one day, in the second car the next day. They are regulars who are going up and down. rather than all of them, all the four of them taking their own vehicles up and down, wear and tear of the vehicle, fuel consumption of the vehicle, and the most important, what they are trying to achieve is to travel from, let's say, point A to point B. What they are trying to do is, since to avoid cost, or let's say to reduce their operating costs, they come together, pull in together. Nowadays we have an app also, if I'm not mistaken, for that. Blah blah. Yeah, means you get together and you blah 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 blah. You keep talking to each other, and pata hi nahi chalta ki journey kabhi chalu hua aur kab khatam ho gaya. That is what the basic, I believe, is blah and blah. Okay, and you talk everything under the sun or under the sky. As far as the operating costs are concerned, remember, wear and tear of the tires are reduced. Wear and tear of the engines are reduced. Wear and tear, or let's say the fuel costs, are also kept down. If you have a driver, for example, all four of them employing a driver, you have only one person or one driver which is being employed for that specific day. So, cutting costs is the most important thing. Reducing wear and tear. At the end of the day, it is all savings, time and efforts, or let's say, at the end of the day, all this translates into money. So it's saving of costs, which means, like those four people, or like the two people who are going up and down every day and their vehicle is not fully occupied, it is 50%, 20% or 30% occupied, that means there is not enough inducement that is there to fill up the vehicle. It is better to have one vehicle which can carry all of them. And how much have you spent? Fuel cost for A and B is the same. Per day, if your vessel is burning 100 tons of fuel, and today at an average, let's say, of $200, what are you looking at the fuel cost per day? Yes? For a 20-day voyage, or a 30-day voyage, or a 60-day round trip, what would be this cost? One more. See, how much is it? This is just the fuel cost. Now, if you divide this fuel cost, which is anyway going to be there, for which will be incurred by A, which will be incurred by B. If you take all both of them together on one ship, it will straightaway be divided by 2. If you take 3 people, let's say, and they are at, let's say, 30, 30 and 30% fill factor, it makes sense in that case to form a consortium. Like we spoke about 10 cubics, 10 cubics, 10 cubics of consolidation cargo into one, and you pay the freight for only one box. Similar case, the vessel also. This is just about the fuel cost. Remember, you will have wharfage cost, or let's say port cost, port calling cost, which is there, and you will have the daily running cost, which will include the cost of the crew, for example. All those costs are then straight away divided by not 2, it will be divided by 3. See the amount of savings that you do. And this makes sense, especially during the time of recession, or when the cargo flow is low, or when we talk it as a demand and supply situation is relatively lesser. It makes sense to get in vessels together, which means it's not necessary that all of them have to have vessels. If you have 3 people who are putting in 3, 3 and let's say 2 vessels together, or 2, 2 and 2 and 2, 4 partners putting 2, 2 vessels together, forming a consortium of 8 vessels, it will also be called as a VSA or a consortium. Indamex service, which operates between India to the US. The Indamex service operates between India to the US. what is the India-American Express, Indamex? What does this achieve? It achieves wherein you have partners like Hapag-Lloyd, CMA-CGM, NYK, all these people coming together, putting their cargo on one ship and running it between India to the US. And the cost that is there is apportioned depending on the allocation that is given, what you were mentioning. So if you load 1000 TEUs, proportionately, if all the tonnages put together, okay, if it's 6000 TEU capacity vessel, it is 1/6 of your, that means the contribution that you need to give. Not for the entire 6000 you don't pay. So it makes sense, especially a consortium makes sense when you have the cargo flow lower. The moment the cargo flow goes higher, then definitely you can look at this. At the same time, when the freight levels are very low, it definitely makes sense to go into a consortium, because your yield by transporting this 30% has actually come down. Even if it is sometimes 100%, it has come down. What happens in that case? The yield that you get in the market is not enough. So you form consortiums. Of course, as of today, consortiums are allowed only for operational efficiencies. Consortiums cannot be formed for the financial aspects. You cannot discuss rates in a consortium. You cannot start to make a conference and set up a standardization of rates. That is Anti-Competition Act. And you will be fined under the Anti-Competition Act. It is anti-competition, that thing. However, for achieving operational, let's say, efficiencies in terms of reducing the number of costs, in terms of port call costs, reducing the cost in terms of the fuel, who is going to benefit at the end of the day? It is the consumer. That is not considered, or let's say it is not listed under the anti-competition, provided it is for operational efficiency. We have consortiums, various consortiums that are formed. You have the P3, okay, which was later, let's say, cancelled and made as a 2M. The reason why the P3 was not given the go ahead was because they were commanding a market share of more than 31%, which means they could end up in a situation influencing the rates. That's why the permission was not given to or go ahead with the P3. The P3 was supposed to be formed by big giants, number one Maersk, number two MSC, number three CMA-CGM. So what happened? It was the 2M which was formed. Their market share was less than 31% and they went ahead with that consortium. India to the Europe consortium, for example. Okay. India to Europe, correction, on the 2M service, which was between the Far East and Europe, let's say CMA-CGM came out and CMA-CGM formed a different consortium with UAC and Costco. They called themselves as the Ocean 3, O3. So UAC, CMA-CGM and Costco decided to pull in their vessels. Okay. So they don't need to take more vessels on charter, let's say, from the market. Just with two services, they can operate this loop. What they want to serve the trade. They don't want to get out of that specific trade, remember. Because of the low inducement of cargo, they would have been forced to get out of that trade. But because the consortium was formed, they are still in the trade. India to Europe trade lane, you had at the consortium of the ISES, Indian Subcontinent to Europe Service, ISES. There were five players in this consortium. When the volumes had gone down in 2009, okay, very bad, there was not enough cargo in the market. All the four players backed out. It was only SCI who was remaining. So MSC and SCI joined hands together and they ran this consortium. So each and every place, this consortium is also formed on short legs as well, between India to the Middle East, for example. And in such a case, you don't need to sometimes put in a vessel. All you need to do is to buy slots on that service. Of course, it can be a slot swap, which you take space of 300 between India to Middle East and you give space between Chennai to Far East. So 100 slots you take here and 100 slots you give in your consortium to those other players. Okay, so that is what is called as a consortium. Sorry, you were asking something. In between you had put your hand up. No. Okay.
Sir,
yes, please.
Sir, means that cost is divided between the players. Means that 12 lakh is divided between the three players if there are three players.
Yes, the cost, it's not 12 lakhs. I mean, say this is just an indicative figure I've given you. There are a lot of other costs which are associated. You have the fuel cost, you have the crew cost, let's say the daily running cost, the DRC of the vessel, then gets divided between the troop. In blah blah, what is there? In blah blah, it clearly states that whatever cost is there between Mumbai to Pune, if I have to go, I just log into the app. And I know that where they are meeting, okay, at Maitri Park we are meeting in Chembur and then straight we are going to Pune. The total cost which will come at the end of the voyage would be 900 rupees. What do three of us do? Three of us, we will split the cost. 300, 300, 300. What has happened? I have achieved what I wanted. What was I wanting? I wanted to go from Mumbai to Pune. What was the actual cost that I would have paid if I would have taken my own car? 900 rupees. But three of us coming together, what have I saved? 600 rupees. Apart from 600 rupees, these are the costs which are readily realized. There are other costs which will not be accounted for immediately, which will not be realized immediately. The wear and tear of my own vehicle, the wear and tear of your vehicle, because we are both traveling in, let's say, her vehicle. So even the wear and tear cost, for example, that can also be apportioned. But since we are into an agreement where all three cars will be used every alternate, let's say, or every 3 days, we know that the wear and tear is something that is there for you, for her and for me. Okay. Of course, it shouldn't be a case where you are using a Mercedes, for example. She comes with her Tata Indica. And I come with my Maruti 800. In that case, you will say my wear and tear cost is much higher. Remember this always. Then it is difficult. Then you will say, now, out of 900 rupees that is there, which is the fuel cost, my daily running cost of maintenance cost of the vehicle is another 300 rupees. You have to give me more 200 rupees. I said, sorry, we never mentioned that you have to get a Mercedes. Yes? That is a different thing. Here we are talking purely in terms of the operational intake capacity. Yes, there are times when, for example, there will be certain people who will be coming only till Talegaon, midway. In such a case, he has got the slots only till Talegaon. So he also comes on board, he doesn't need to put a vessel, but he pays only for that specific leg. So we charge him accordingly. You need slots till Talegaon, you need the seat till Talegaon, okay, not 300, but you pay 150 or 200 rupees. So he picks up on a regular basis this slot every time. For us, doesn't make a difference because we still have place for one more person in the vehicle. Apart from the three of us, one more person joins and he pays this one. What has eventually happened? The total cost of 900 rupees is then shared between four of us, depending on the slots what he is taking till where. Our cost comes further down. So that 150 which we collect from him can also be beneficial for the three of us. This is how the calculation takes place in general to understand. As far as the consortiums are concerned. Okay?
they internally have their own.
See, generally the operating cost, like I said, the operating cost, for example, he gets a Mercedes, okay, which has got what efficiency does it give? 7.5 kilometers a liter. What would be the fuel cost when we drive in his vehicle? Imagine. It will be twice the cost what we go into the Tata. And it will be maybe 3 times higher than when you go into a 800, which gives the best fuel efficiency. Assuming, I don't want to, don't quote me on any brand efficiency here, but I'm just giving an example. So, can we get into that? No. When vessel sharing agreements are done, you are putting vessels with the intake capacity. Your running cost is different. But at the end of the day, what have you achieved? You have achieved a operational efficiency in terms of the slots that you occupy. So you will be interested in your two vessels, and these two vessels, or two vessels of his or two vessels of her, they will all be nothing but standardized ones. You cannot have a vessel which where you have, you put, let's say, a 10,000 TU vessel in that same service. It happens. You have consortiums, for example, where you have most of the players have got 9,000 TU vessel. One guy comes in which is 5,000 TU vessel. What happens now? Are we obliged, let's say, he gets his 10,000 TU vessel, both of us, are we obliged to pay him for the 10,000 TU vessel? We tell him, boss, it's a very clear cut thing. We are three of us, okay, we need only 3 seats. If you bring a Tata Innova or a Toyota Innova, you take care of the other 2 seats if you want to take more passengers. That is your baby. We are not interested in that. We will pay basis this 3 people only. That is what is called as the owner's merit. That is what is called as the owner's merit. The NEMO service, which comes from Australia into south of India and then goes into Europe. You have CMA CGM and Hapag-Lloyd, which are partners in that service. Hapag-Lloyd has got vessels which are relatively smaller in size, 4,500 TUs, 5,000 TU vessels. All of a sudden, CMA CGM says, I have a big vessel of 7,000, 8,000 TU vessel, which I will be also sending in the same loop. When that vessel comes, is Hapag-Lloyd from 5,000 means Hapag-Lloyd 2,500, CMA CGM 2,500. But if CMA CGM's one vessel comes bigger, do you think Hapag-Lloyd has to use the remaining slots? No. It will be still considered as a 5,000 TU vessel, 2,500 for Hapag-Lloyd, 2,500 for CMA CGM, and the balance 2,000 or 3,000 TUs which are there, that is for CMA CGM, which will be called as a owner's merit. So they can load more, which means three of us, 300, 300, 300 is fine. He has got a bigger car, he can pick up him, he can pick up him. 150, 150 which he charges him goes into his kitty.
But sir, that Hapag-Lloyd is not concerned about whatever more difference he is getting in the profit.
My contribution is this, because we have agreed for the 3 people. So he can get to recover his additional costs which is there. Okay, what he does, he calls him and he calls him also. Blah blah, whatever it is. 150, 150, 300 rupees, he has also recovered more. That 300 goes into his kitty. We are not interested in that. We will pay him 300 because that is our cost for going. Fine?
Sir, conferences don't exist now, no?
Conferences don't exist. Let's say the question is that conferences don't exist. Conferences are still existing. The Trans-Pacific Conference, if I am not mistaken, still exists. But as far as the Europe and India and the US is concerned, the conferences, let's say, are not there. In US, okay, in the US, open conference is still existing. But close conferences are not existing. Because close conferences do not promote, you can say, the competition. Where they not allow any new player to come in. Open conferences are free, Close conferences are where all three of us, we will form a group and we will not allow anybody else to come in. I will not allow him to increase the size of the vessel also. So 4000 TEU vessels only. We will not allow him to increase the size of the vessels. By doing that, what are you trying to do? You are actually trying to limit the supply in the market. Tomorrow if the demand increases, no, we will not allow the size to increase. We will not allow anybody else to come into the trade. That is what it is. So conferences are considered to be anti-competition. That's why legally they are not permitted to operate. So the anti-competition law prevents the conferences to operate. The conferences earlier used to set up the BAF, the CAF level, or let's say the tariff level for India to Europe or India to US. Every month the bunker adjustment factor would be $300. The currency adjustment factor would be 14%, and they used to set up the entire thing. Nowadays it is not.
So while discussing benefits of ICD and CFS, you mentioned reduced inventory cost.
Reduced inventory cost in terms of for the lines. Okay, because the turnaround time of the box then increases. Of course, in ICDs also the turnaround time of the box increases. But inventory costs are reduced because of the position of the ICDs close to the factory. That is for the shipper as well as for the shipping line. If it is going into the ICD, the entire voyage, now the scope of the voyage is increased. It is not that it is stopped over here and then it is going to the factory and then coming back. For the shipper on the other side, inventory cost means his entire inventory that he has to maintain at the ICDs. Since the ICD is closer to his factory, he can maintain a lower stock over there. So that is what we mention the word lower inventory stocks. Inventory is not container inventory, inventory is also for the cargo aspects of it. General average in liner trade and multimodal transport.
I think in 2011 there is some question about this. Line trade okay, no. It's a liner trade question.
I hope you are not looking for 2016 question paper.
Somewhere I can find.
Generally, it is not on a voyage basis, it is formed on a long-term basis. Long-term, again, is a generalized term. It is fixed for a period of 1 year, it can be fixed for a period of 6 months, it can be fixed for a period of 5 years, even for a 10-year period. It can be subject to certain terms and conditions wherein it can be for a period of 5 years, subject to a review at the 2-year interval or a 3-year interval. Those kind of terms and conditions are very clear. Suddenly you see today the market is low. That is the reason why the 2M and the O3 have been formed. Okay. Tomorrow if the world volume trade, let's say, increases tremendously, it shouldn't be a case where they lose out. Because the O3 is there, they have indications mutually also. We have agreed, let's say, the three of us have agreed that you don't put another vessel in the same Mumbai-Pune route. And then leave out. What will happen? I was planning my budget basis three of us going together regularly. Now what is happening is, because the freight levels and everything has gone up, you have actually, he has gone ahead and he has put a separate vessel and he is traveling with somebody else. That's why nobody goes for a 10-year consortium, generally. Nobody goes for a 10-year consortium. It will be subject to a review after 2 years, after 3 years, after whatever it is. That will always be there. They normally take into consideration the cycle of how the volumes have been moving historically. From the 1930 or 1910 onwards, they would have seen how the peak comes, how the recession strikes every 7 years, like the Indira Vikas Patra or everything. They will have that entire trend that is there. Everything can be predicted, kind of a stuff. Of course, there are things which is also not predicted. Otherwise, if people can predict all these things, by now we would all been God and we would have been employed by the at the highest package by all the major shipping lines. If we could be, our analytical skills are so good. It's good, analysis is good to understand. But it's not necessary that these are always having a 100% strike rate. In Mumbai or in, let's say, India, the throughput out of India was always considered on the exports leg, was always considered to be on the lower side during the month of December and Jan. You had a seasonal curve. You had a curve where what used to happen is, during the month of March, financial year ending, during the month of April, because the March end cargo finally exits the gates, and April you have this one, May, June, July, August, September, again half yearly closing that is there, okay, and then November, trickling effect, let's say, of that cargo, and December, and then Jan. This is how the trend used to be there of the cargo. Two crest and two troughs. 2013 and 14 was a different trend altogether. December and Jan actually started picking up. It went this way. And March and April actually came slightly down. See this. See the graph, how it has actually reflected now. There are a lot of companies which have shifted, you can say, their financial year endings, which was as per the financial year ending, which has shifted, let's say, to a calendar year ending, the financials. Entire thing will shift. And most of the companies, if you see their export volumes, during the quarter endings or the financial year endings or half yearly endings, it actually picks up by almost 30%. It's also not just because of the financial year endings. Remember, this trade is linked in many ways. During June, July, August, we feel during June and July that the volumes are low. Why the volumes are low? Heavy rain, all those stuff, agri movements are not there and everything. Do you think agri movements are not there? Agri movements are there during that time also. But it is just that June and July, because August and September are the peak summer months in Europe, when most of the people go on holidays, whether it is in the manufacturing sector, whether it is in the port sector, wherever it is. So manufacturing is at its all-time low in Europe, or consumption of those commodities are at an all-time low in that season. So there is no exports from here to reach there in August and September. That is the reason why this things are low. But after July, August, September, October, 4 months, there is a peak again which comes. We say it is the September half yearly ending. But let us also realize that December is Christmas in Europe. So they need all the important things for Christmas in Europe. Everybody buys things, gifts. Why is it that the imports into India is at the high during August, September, October, November? Because of the Dashara and the Diwali which is there. In Delhi, there is a whole lot of containers which are actually coming from Far East and everywhere into India. So on the imports in India, that is at a high. So it's actually most of the time it crisscrosses the imports and the exports.
So we can use that supply demand thing.
Always, it's all about supply and demand. The consortiums have also been formed basically for that purpose. Yeah, sorry.
Urban scope and urban spoke.
It's written scope.
Yeah.
Okay, there is no In simple words, what we need to understand is, what is a hub? What do you understand by the word hub? We in fact started off the class today with this same thing.
Center.
A fan, when you see it in the ceiling, we call that as a hub, and we call as the blades of the fan or the vanes of the fan, V-A-N-E-S, the vanes of the fan, and the center one is the hub where the motor is there, let's say. So that is the hub. When you have a motorcycle, where are the brakes? The brakes are in the hub. The hub is actually opened up for the brakes. The olden ones where you had the spring control drum brakes, that is the hub. And what are the one which are going out, radiating out? The spoke. So same is the concept as far as a hub is concerned. I do understand it's not spherical in shape, but this is what is called as the hub, and you have the spokes radiating out. The most important, when you talk about any service, for example, a vessel which calls, let's say, Corfakan, it calls Malta, then it calls, let's say, Rotterdam, for example, liner trade. Hub and spoke arrangements are associated with liner trade concept. A train, for example, is an example of a, if you remember the first year we learnt about this, remember the taxi guy who starts off in Colaba, he goes to New Bombay, goes to Andheri, goes, comes back to Worli and comes back in the night over there. He didn't know where he was going, what he was doing and everything. At the same time, you had the liner trade which was following a scheduled route, scheduled dates and time of arrival. So the cargo was also coming in, which means if you have to go from your house, you know you will catch the rick in the morning at 7:45. You will reach the station at 8 o'clock. You will catch the 8 o'clock local and you will get down, let's say, at Dadar. At Dadar, when you get down, you will catch the bus to go to Prabhadevi. Multimodal transport. And the connections are also available accordingly. Now, it could be a case where you don't need to be actually always multimodal. It could also be that you are coming in at Kurla and changing over to a train which is going to Vashi. So, 8 o'clock from here, 8:30 at Kurla, crossover, 8:40 is a train from Kurla to Vashi. Where you need to go? To Vashi. This train which is there doesn't go to Vashi. Let's assume a case. What happens over here? Liner trade generally calls the major hubs. Remember, the idea of the hub and spoke is not, is also one thing is where the ships cannot go to all these ports wherever cargo is destined to. There is not enough inducement of cargo to go to these ports. There is not enough infrastructure capabilities to go to these ports, because the vessels which are deployed are the 4000 TEU vessels, whereas the capacity of handling at these small ports where cargo is coming of 150 TEUs, 60 TEUs per week, need not, it won't justify for a big vessel of 5000 TEUs to call at that port. It doesn't have the infrastructure. Plus, what is the use of handling, I mean adding multiple ports? So that is important. The hub then serves as a distribution center. We also call it, for various, let's say in the supply chain, let's say industry, we have something which is also called as a distribution hub. When a truck with cars from the Manesar plant, okay, comes to Mumbai, it has got a distribution hub where it comes and offloads all the vehicles. Does it go to individual retailer and gives 10 cars, 10 cars, 10 cars? No. The big truck comes and everything is offloaded. If you go to the Panvel area outside the octroi limits, let's say, or outside the city limits of Mumbai, you will find huge areas where cars are parked. Those are the distribution hubs, you can say. From there, what is required in Thane, 30 cars. From there, what is required in Dadar for the regional registration, 30 cars. From there, what is required in Baikala, 30 cars are sent. Same is the case as far as the hubs are concerned. When the moment it comes to, let's say, Khor Fakkan, what happens from Khor Fakkan? You have cargo for Djibouti. From Khor Fakkan, you have cargo for, let's say, Port Sudan. From Khor Fakkan, you have cargo for Mogadishu. From Khor Fakkan, you have cargo for Berbera. From Khor Fakkan, you have cargo for Sokhna. You have cargo for Aden. You have cargo for, let's say, Hodeida. And you have cargo for Salala. This is how the entire Red Sea area is covered, let's say, and the Middle East area is covered through the strategic hub of Khor Fakkan. And why do you think is Khor Fakkan? Because it has got draft availability, that means infrastructure availability. At the same time, there are a lot of companies who have invested in the hub over here. It is their own terminal. Forget Khor Fakkan now. You come to the next transshipment point, that is Malta. What happens now? From Malta, you cover all the Adriatic ports of Ravenna, you cover Trieste, you cover Ancona, you cover Bari, and then you cover, let's say, Koper, and you cover Venice. At the same time, you cover Gioia Tauro, you cover Salerno in the West Med area. Okay, this is the West Mediterranean area in the world. So, it is a strategic location. If you see the world map, it is located right in the center of the Mediterranean Sea, Malta. And from there, East Med, West Med, Adriatic, Turkey, all those areas, North Africa, everything is served. What is this? It is a hub. And what are the others? They are the spokes. And the same thing works on the exports, outwards. And for the imports, it works inwards. Or for the feeder port of Koper, whatever comes in is imports and whatever goes out of Koper is exports. Liner shipping companies, apart from taking care of the economies of scale in terms of deploying bigger ships, okay, in these ports where infrastructure capabilities are much better than all these ports, remember, also invest heavily in these transshipment ports. Because there is a cost which is associated when you transship a cargo. There is a cost where there is a lift off from that main vessel which calls at Malta, and there is a movement to the small vessel and loading on the small vessel which is also there. So that cost today is something which is relatively higher when you compare to the overall cost. So having your own terminal in these areas, strategically located in the entire geography of the world map, helps quite a lot. So whether it is Khor Fakkan in the Middle East, whether it is Malta in the Mediterranean, whether it is Rotterdam in Europe, or it is Port Kelang in the Far East, all these are strategic hubs for the shipping line companies having excellent infrastructure. Yes, please. Spokes. Exactly. So now you come, let's say, to the next one. We put Colombo over here. What happens? If Colombo is the hub, you will have Cochin, you have Mangalore, you have Goa, you have Vizag, you have Tuticorin, you have Chennai, you have Kolkata, and you have Haldia. The entire Indian subcontinent or peninsula of India is covered by the hub port of Colombo. Take Rotterdam for instance. I can go for the entire Scandinavian ports, the North European outports that are there, and the Irish ports which is also there. Similar way. That is what is a hub port and a spoke arrangement. Another thing, the vessel when it calls at a port, remember it cannot call for just about 50 odd TUs, it has to justify the call cost. If you have to go for a parking area, okay, if they are going to charge you 100 rupees, definitely you need to have sufficient number of people who can actually make good of that 100 rupees, otherwise it is a waste. So you are parking over here for onloading and offloading boxes, that means moves that is there. So it is better, rather than going and calling all these ports, it is better you call at one main port. Remember, even schedule integrity plays a lot of role over here. What happens in such case? You have total discharge for Malta, which would be Ravenna 50, Trieste 50, all these 50-50 each. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 into 50, 400 TUs get discharged at Malta. It makes sense to call that port. If the same thing happens with Rotterdam, the same thing happens with Corfakan, the same thing will happen with Port Calang also, or Colombo. That is the reason why you have the hub and spoke arrangements which are coming in. For liner trade, hub and spoke policy is one of the most important things that is there to create operational efficiency and costs as well, reducing costs. Fine. Let's put it this way. Can I rephrase your sentence that the questions would be easier or it would be tough?
No, are there questions that will come
100%? No, the questions that are there, you know the past papers which are there, okay, and more or less all the questions are based on that only. These are certain things, remember, the basics have to be understood. Okay, dynamics of shipping changes on a day-to-day basis. What has been taught in the class or what are there in the books could be old things, outdated, what we call it. But the reason of coming to the class or to read a thing is to understand the basic. What was taught to you in the class in your school days was not something that you needed to remember throughout your life. But if you have understood the basic, you could apply that basics later on. And that is what used to be taught in the school. Archimedes' principle, which used to be taught in the school. What is it? It's the basic of shipping, how a ship floats. And I know nobody in the class now looks at me eye to eye, because Archimedes' principle, again this guy has started. On top of that, we have one person who has got dark glasses as well. No offense, please. Yeah? So, as far as the examination is concerned, each and every question has to be approached in a particular way. Okay? There has to be a basics that needs to be explained. If you have an explanation in terms of citing examples, then put all the examples over there. At the same time, and for God's sake, don't put the train which is there and put the stations. Yes, there has been cases where it has been mentioned. Okay, so please do not do that. At the same time, you need to mention by points very clearly. Do not write stories. It has to be very clear, crisp and clean in points. Infrastructure capabilities, cost efficiencies, productivity. These are the ones which are the main features of a hub port. That is the reason why liner trade, because schedule integrity is one of the premium things as far as the liner trade is concerned. That is the reason why in liner trade, hub and spoke arrangements plays a very, very important role. So these are the points that needs to be highlighted, and for each point you can explain what are the reasons, what infrastructure capabilities are we talking about. Are we talking about cranes which can handle these post-Panamax vessels? Are we talking about cranes? You know the post-Panamax container ships, right? which are more than, let's say, 6,500 TUs, 9,000 TU vessels, 14,000 TU vessels, Neo-Panamax vessels, which are 14,000 TU ships, or 20,000 TU ships nowadays, which we see. Can it be handled, let's say, in Mangalore? No. Can it be handled in Colombo? Yes. That is the reason why these ships call Colombo. And the cargo which is on board for Mangalore will go on smaller ships. Simple as that. You do the same thing for you. There is a road mode of transportation. You get into a bus, get on the main bus stop, and from there what do? You take a rig to go home. Isn't it? A smaller capacity. How do you tell the bus driver, no, take me right at my doorstep. That lane he even can't enter. What is he going to do? Can he go? Not possible. And for one person, does it make justify the deviation? No. So what he does, he comes on the main road. How many people get down? 20 people get down. And 20 people board also. Who are the 20 people? They are coming from the various colonies who are there. Same thing, the 20 people who get down also go to the various colonies. That is the same funda what is there in the liner trade as well. Nothing different. And that concept is something that needs to, when I give examples, is for you to get the basics right. Once the basics are in, you can form your own answer. You can write your own answer. Like we used to say, I will write it in my own words. Yeah? What else?
So what is alliance and why there is a need for
alliance? Alliance between two carriers are the same what we called as consortium. It is the same thing. There are a lot of times when you actually go to board an aircraft from here to Cochin, okay, or from here to, let's say, Nagpur. Air France can give you a ticket right till Nagpur if you fly from Paris to Nagpur. The only difference is when you fly from Paris to Mumbai and from Mumbai to Nagpur, it will be a Jet Airways flight. They have an alliance, Star Alliance. I'm sure you might have heard this word. Welcome on board Jet Airways following flight, and we are a member of the Star Alliance group, and we welcome all the other passengers of the entire alliance. What does it mean? You are a Jet Airways ticket holder, but he and he are not booked on Jet Airways. They are booked on something else. The same thing happens in an alliance, and when they go on a consortium, if you book the cargo with MSC and he books the cargo with SCI, both are on the same ship. The vessel's name is SCI Mumbai only. But the bill of lading or the ticket or the way bill that has been issued to you is from the carrier called as MSC, and for him is by the carrier called SCI, and from him is a carrier called as K-Line. Yes, please.
What is an EIR?
EIR. Is it fine? Then we move to the next one.
Yes.
Anything to do with the hub and spoke concept? Alliance, consortium?
And this the new global liner G6 network and what's that?
The G6 network is the same thing what we talked about. G6 is a very old, consortium that is there. Okay, partners which are calling from, let's say, Far East into Europe, G6. The new ones that is there is the 2M. Between Maersk and MSC, and the O3, which is between CMACGM, UASE and COSCO. So these are various alliances and consortiums that has been formed. Okay. That's it. Perfect. Shall I take this off? Correct? Okay. Equipment, interchange, report. An EIR is one of the most important things in the entire transportation chain. If I come across to you and I tell you, I am giving you this mobile phone, please deliver it to my friend over there. The moment I hand over this mobile to you, you take it from me. Let's say, for example, if this mobile phone is cracked from behind and you see that, or the glass is cracked and you tell him that isko jara jaake deliver kar dena, what is the first thing that you will tell me? Or will you just go and deliver it over there? It's cracked, it's damaged. If I know you very well, you are my friend, then you will anyway notice it. Remember, you as a carrier, always, the moment you get something in your hand, and if you are a carrier, that means a delivery person, what is the first and foremost thing that you should do? You have a check and you will record the facts. I'll give you another example, the best one to note. You have a vehicle. You go to the service center to give the vehicle. What is the first thing that they do? They have a form with a vehicle specification outline on that. What does he come and do? He takes a full look at the vehicle. He goes and sits inside the vehicle. He notes the fuel gauge readings. He notes the mileage or the odometer readings. He comes out and he notes all the remarks. If the headlight is broken, he will put a remark. If the tail light is scratched or broken, he will put a remark. Odometer reading 60,000 kilometers, he will put a remark of 60,000 kilometers. Fuel gauge quarter, half, three quarters, full, he will make a remark. What is it that he is doing? So that in the evening when you come, instead of 60,000 kilometers, or after 2 days when you come, you will see the odometer over there, 62,000. Are you comfortable with that? No, you will not accept. You will actually question him in the last 2 days. How did this jump from 60 to 62,000? That is the reason why he comes and he is noting down the facts. What is happening over here is, there is an equipment, that is a vehicle, which is interchanging hands. And to record the facts, whenever anything interchanges hands, when I give you the mobile phone to give it to him, since you are the custodian, okay, I'll use some legal words, since you are the custodian here, you will make sure that you will not have any liability on that. That is the reason why you are noting down these things. You have the liability is a different thing. But sometimes down below you will have even other remarks also. Equipment interchange report is there at each and every place where the item or the equipment interchanges hands. An EIR has to be there when a shipper from his premises gives his cargo, let's say, to the truck when it is getting stuffed. The truck driver or the transporter is actually, can he get anybody? No, he gets people whom he trusts always, the drivers. What is the driver noting? The driver is noting down the condition of the boxes. If there are two boxes or cases which were broken and leaking and has been loaded, do you think the transporter will not make a note in his challan? He will. At the same time, when it comes at the CFS, let's say for stuffing, when it comes at the CFS and it has to be stuffed into a container, the CHA or the stuffing contractor who is doing the stuffing, he will also make a equipment interchange report. And he will note over there, two boxes found leaking. The moment it goes into the container which was picked up by the transporter, he will also make a note of the container. The container when it is loaded or when it is getting gated inside the port, there also it will be noted. If there is a heavy dent in the container, immediately the terminal operator will inform the carrier or the shipping line representative that we will not allow this cargo or this container to get in because this has got this problem. An EIR is made. When the terminal loads it on the ship, the ship's chief officer or the duty officer on board the ship, if he sees that this container is coming on board the ship with damages, he will make a EIR. You don't make EIRs for the entire thing. You make a EIR only if there is a damage when this scale of activities are happening. Of course, for a car, whether you have a damage or not, it will be noted. But when 2000 containers are getting loaded on board the ships, you don't sit down and make EIRs for all. But if there is a damage or a dent or a tear which is there on a container outside, let's say, you will immediately note it down in your report. There will be an EIR on board the ship that you will follow. Like how you have for the car servicing the cars, let's say, diagram, same thing, the containers diagram is there on a EIR. The net is connected here?
Yes.
Duplicate, right?
Yes.
Equipment interchange receipt, EIR. A document required when transferring a cargo container from one vessel to other or to a shipping terminal. The receipt includes the container number, vessel voyage code, stacking position and stowage position. Anything else that is there is also noted over there. Same thing when your car goes for servicing. What is it that you are telling? You are writing down all the things, and that is exactly that is there. Equipment interchange receipt. It's a record that is made, and in the equipment interchange receipt, what are written? Container number, the type, the vessel voyage and the owner. When it is going out or whether it is coming in. Are you receiving it or are you giving it? So you will be making this report even for the mobile phone that I give you, or even for a vessel which is, or a car which is going in the service center. Same thing for the container also, the same thing will be maintained. Everything will be there, the terminal, the loading port, whether it is empty or whether it is loaded. If the seal is there, that is also mentioned over there. It shouldn't be a case that I give you a container with a seal and finally when you deliver it, it is without seal. What would you do? If the seal is broken, you could have tampered with the goods. Will he apply? I mean, will he accept? No. Which means the EIR which I have in my custody when I give it to you has to have the same seal number. And that has to match physically with the same seal that is there when you deliver it to him. And he will also check the same thing. If the seal is getting tampered, he will not accept that. This is what is called. And dent, hole, cut, bruise. Which side? Each and everything is marked. This is what is called as a EIR that is there. Clear? Generally, containers which goes into the yard, they prepare it for each and every container. I don't want to get into that topic of insurance. Reason being, again it's a debatable issue, because insurance for an empty container, whenever a container is assured, it is not covered. TT Club doesn't cover, according to my information. It's only when the empty containers or laden containers are on board the ship, it is covered. Both for empty and full. But assure, for containers, it is not covered. It is a transporter who picks up, takes the insurance when he actually picks up a container. And it is a shipper who takes the insurance for the cargo, not for the container. Yes, please. Maximum gross weight. Okay, the maximum gross weight of a container the maximum authorized mass means the weight of a vehicle or trailer, whatever it is. This is the gross, sorry, this is not the correct definition. I would get you some images that would be there as far as the maximum gross weight is concerned. I think this is a better. There are four markings generally which you will have on a container. And on a container you will see there will be something called as a tare weight. A tare weight is nothing but the empty container weight. A tare weight, T-A-R-E, okay, no need to spell it as tare. It is a tare weight of a container, it is an empty container weight. Then you have the net weight. People at times call net weight as payload, which is correct. This net weight includes, or payload includes, the cargo weight plus the packaging weight and the pallet weight also. The net weight includes the cargo, the packaging, okay, and the pallets as well. Lot of times you will have the intermediaries like the freight forwarders or the CHAs using a word as gross cargo weight, which includes this. Okay. Now this net weight or payload, which forms the cargo weight, the packaging weight and the pallets, that means anything that is, the container is empty, anything that you put inside the container, including the lashing materials, let's say, which you use to lash the cargo in place, everything becomes the payload or the net weight. Payload or the net weight. If you calculate the tare weight and if you add the tare and the net, it becomes the gross weight of the container. That means if you have an empty container, the weight of this is the tare weight. If you have the cargo, this is the payload or the net weight. If you have the container with the cargo, tear plus payload or tear plus net is the MGW, which is the maximum gross weight expressed in tons or in kgs. Next. Cu cap is nothing but cubic capacity of a container. For a 20 footer, it should be in the range of around 33 metric cubes. For a 40 foot DV, it should be in the range of around 65 or 66 cubic, and 76 or 77 cubic for a 40 high cube. In this case, the cubic capacity is 33.5 metric cube. This is a marking of a 20 foot standard container. It is the cubic capacity or the volume that is there inside this container. What else?
Triaxial surcharge, or the difference between pendulum servicer and RPW servicer.
Okay. Fine. End-to-end service, India to Europe, Europe to India. Pendulum service. What is a pendulum? Anything that goes. This is the mean. If it goes to this side, crosses over and comes back. Right? This is what we call it as a pendulum. The same thing happens if the vessel from Far East comes to Indian subcontinent, goes to the Middle East Gulf, again comes back into the Middle East continent, Indian subcontinent, and goes into the Far East. It is called as a pendulum service. Fine. At the same time, there is something called as a RTW. Round the world service. Earlier, there used to be round the world service on a regular basis, where the cargo, the origin used to start, let's say, from US West Coast. It used to come all the way into Asia. Then from Asia, it used to cross the Suez Canal, go to Europe. And then from Europe, it used to go back across the Pacific Ocean, let's say Atlantic Ocean, into US East Coast, cross the Panama Canal, and then come to the US West Coast. Over a period of time, liner trade evolved in such a way that they preferred shorter loops. Plus, the Panama Canal had some restrictions in terms of the transits. The bigger vessels couldn't transit the Panama Canal. You had a restriction imposed, like a Panamax size of vessels, 32 meters broad. Nowadays, of course, with the Panama Canal, let's say, being broadened, you may see some of the round the world service starting up again. But definitely, in terms of the end-to-end service, it has actually taken over the round the world. So, all this from US West Coast to Far East, they have made it end-to-end service. So, they have split the round the world service into smaller pieces. Remember, liner trade, the most important thing what we said was schedule integrity. And the moment you have long trips, the schedule integrity always goes for a toss. The basic idea of a liner service is lost. That is the reason why end-to-end service takes, let's say it is sellable in the market than a round-the-world service. Yes, ports are always fixed. It's a liner service. It's always fixed. You can have tram trade also doing the round the world service, just for information. But in liner trade type, yes, round the world service is there. In fact, some years back, MSC had a round the world service. It was called as the Golden Gate service. GGS it was called. When they launched it, the GGS service used to start from the Far East, go across into Asia, from Far East, come across into Europe, through the Middle East, into Europe, and then from Europe it used to go across the Atlantic to US East Coast, cross the Panama Canal, go to San Francisco Bay in the US West Coast where the Golden Gate Bridge is there, and from there it used to come back to the Far East. It was called as a Golden Gate service. Schedule integrity, everything went for a toss. What they decided was no more crossing the Panama Canal, and they wanted to put bigger ships. What they did, they made the service from GGS to GGPS, Golden Gate Pendulum Service. What happened? It starts off from Asia, comes into Middle East, goes to the US, comes back into the Middle East, goes back to Far East. Rather than going like this, the amplitude was straight away chopped over here, and it is only like a GGPS. So GGS became Golden Gate Pendulum Service. Yes, please.
Running down clause,
I wouldn't be. It's more of a legal this one. I would prefer to stay away from that. I wouldn't be the right person to say. I wouldn't like to get into that.
If they ask us,
okay, what are they going to ask us? Shall I answer that also? What questions? This is like telling in the class, you know, sir, do we put 1 star or 3 star on this?
No, I mean, if we are asked to state the list, the pricing factors influencing liner shipping, the pricing factors, or and the next.
Not pricing factors influencing liner shipping.
No.
Is the question, are you reading the question clearly?
Explain the principle of liner pricing.
Explain the principles of liner pricing and the factors influencing the pricing. It's not the pricing factors.
And then explain in detail commodity business.
Exactly. What all do you think would be the ones which would be influencing the pricing or the factors that influences the liner pricing? Demand and supply.
Competition.
Exactly. Your actual net base cost that you are going to incur. See, if your operating cost is 100 rupees, then you can decide whether to sell at 1000 or whether to sell at 500 or 300, whatever it is. So you want to sell, 100 is your base cost. You want to sell, let's say, at 200 and get 200 people inside or 200 containers inside. Or you want to sell at 500 and get only 100 containers or 50 containers inside, is your problem. These are the factors that are there. If you have cargo, fine. And economies of scale is one important thing that works in that favor when you talk about the liner pricing. The port of calls that you are going to make. Are you going to double the port of calls? Like, for example, from Far East to Middle East Gulf. Let's take an example from Shanghai, and you are going into Jebel Ali. What would be the cost that you will pay? Let's assume the freight from Shanghai to Jebel Ali is $900. Okay. What about Shanghai to Indian subcontinent? What do you think would be the freight? 450 is his pricing, okay? Just watch this. 450. But do you know the market from Indian subcontinent to Middle East Gulf doesn't pay much? It pays only 150. So what have you achieved by doing this? You have achieved only As against? Demand and supply situation. That is the reason why this stretch, you need to make sure that you don't charge anything less than. Reason why it is 750 is so that you take this also into account and then go. But do you still think 750 is justified? According to me, no. You charge 850. Why? Because otherwise it's better to run this entire vessel from here to here with $900 of cargo on board. This is what is called as double dip in liner trade. It is generally used as double dip. That means you dip twice into this. And what is happening? Overall, you are actually making $1,000 as against $900. Remember one more thing. These customers who are coming to you will pay you $900 only for a direct service. The moment you deviate, okay, the moment you deviate into Indian subcontinent, straight away they will say, forget this, I'm not going to pay you that. Because your transit time is getting delayed by one more week.
Difference between FCR by international shipping line and a domestic shipping line.
No, I didn't get you.
Difference between international FCR issued by an international shipping line and a domestic shipping line.
No, I wouldn't like to comment on the FCR part of it again. Freight receipts, international shipping line generally do not issue a freight receipt, just for information. They will issue only a bill of lading. It is only the domestic carriers who will issue the bill of lading.
FCR.
Yes. Or let's say not a FCR, but it's a freight certificate, what they call it also.
The cargo can be taken directly without presentation of FCR.
Depends. In domestic markets, yes. But in international markets, it cannot. But again, laws are different in various countries. For example, today, if a cargo reaches the country of Brazil, there is a rule as far as the local laws are concerned that the consignee, if he can justify that he is the lawful owner without holding the bill of lading in his hand, if he says that yes, he has paid for so and so goods, he can take the delivery of the cargo without the bill of lading. Chittagong, for example, we have had cases where the cargo has gone into Bangladesh. The cargo has been taken, delivery has been taken by the consignee without producing the original bill of lading. You cannot hold on to that. He will straight away go to the local court and say that this is my cargo. He will prove it to the court that he has paid for the goods. And you as a line are obliged to give him the delivery. If not, you will get the summons from the court. So each and every country is different. What is going on, man, over there? In fact, this guy also is shifted from here to there. No, I'm talking about the last guy. Anyway, what else? Ah, okay. Understood. If anybody wants to leave, we have finished with the class officially. Let's say if anybody wants to leave, can leave. I'm there for another 10 minutes in case any questions are there.
Okay. I think this question we won't get, so FMC and how it affects trade into USA.
FMC. Yeah, FMC is the Federal Maritime Commission. They control the trades which comes into and out of US. Okay. FMC is a body, if I may say so, like which governs the trade so that fair practices are followed by the shipping lines and each and every person who is, let's say, involved in the entire supply chain. Fine? If you Google it, you will get the exact definition. Federal Maritime Commission gets involved in the pricing of the thing, whether it is a sea mode of transport which is coming into the US or the domestic mode of transport which is there. So freight forwarders who are involved in any multimodal activity are also there as far as registered with the FMC. Okay. People who appear on the bill of lading have to be registered with the FMC.
Like
and that is a body which governs the entire trade, and they will make sure in the US, they make sure that everything is transparent, and they make sure that everything is with integrity and, let's say, in terms of the let's say transparent dealing takes place and no unfair practices are followed. There would not be any kind of a cartelization that can be done. That is a basic idea of FMC. It should not be a case where two lines say that we are the ones which are operating into the US and we are the ones who will be giving this. It cannot be a case where you have filed a rate of, let's say, $1,000 with the FMC, and then later on you say, no, pay me $2,000, only then I will give you the delivery of the cargo. And FMC is very strict. They can levy huge penalties in terms of any violation of the FMC norms that is there. Container feedering is the one which we saw between the hub ports and the feeder ports, okay, or the spoke ports, you can say. So that is what is container feedering. The feedering of containers which happens between the main ports and the small ports. I wouldn't like to use the feedership and mothership. Of course, it is something to do with the size of the, let's say, vessels. It also depends on the size of the vessels. Feeder vessel is normally smaller in size when compared to the mother vessel. Feeder vessels feeds cargo to the mother vessel, that means smaller ports to larger ports for exports, and from larger ports into the smaller ports for the imports. Compared to the mother vessel, feeder vessel is relatively slower in terms of its speed. When you talk about the average capacity of the feeder, today of course I would like to add couple of, zeros onto that. 10 at least. So the feeder vessel size ranges anywhere from 500 TUs up to 3000 TUs. Okay. Feeder vessel serves short distance either between small ports or between smaller ports and the major ports. Now this definition of major port is a bigger port, not under the government gazette, the definition of a major port. Fine.
So what is the difference in refrigerated or reefer containers and insulated containers? Like both they use for food transportation?
No, insulated containers are a different type of containers. Nowadays it is not being, let's say, used in a very big way, but insulated containers were there specially when you were actually carrying these molasses, okay, there is a kind of a insulation between the outer shell and the inner container of the cargo, okay. Wine, for example, when it is carried from the Mediterranean to Africa or between the Mediterranean region, it used to be carried in insulated containers, okay, where the outer shape is, let's say, in box, but inner it will be like a case and you will have insulation in that. Okay, I had seen those containers long time back. Nowadays I have never seen, in the recent times I have never seen an insulated container. Refrigerated container, however, has got a clip-on in the olden days and now an integrated system which controls the entire temperature inside the refrigerated container. IICL, International Institute of Container Lessors. Okay, that is the definition that is there. It's a very big topic to discuss. It's a topic by itself. In fact, the ICD, let's say, that we took slide that contains the entire IICL container lessors. The IICL was established Institute of International Container Lessors. Okay, the IICL was established in 1971, let's say, as it became apparent that the safety and equipment quality were a major components of the system. The IICL was instrumental in the development of the International Convention for Safe Containers, and this convention is the most important thing when you see the markings on a container or when you talk about the increased payloads that are being there. The entire structure, how a container should be built, how the floorboard should be there, what would be the weight bearing, let's say, capacity of each and every member, what is the, let's say, load factor or a safe working load of each and every eye where you actually strap or secure the cargo. Each and everything is mentioned. How do you maintain the container? What is the grade of paint that you use on a container? When a container gets damaged, do you just take any Asian paint or let's say Garware paints or anything and strap it? No. It has to be proper quality of paint. What is the material that you will use to do a repair on a container? Each and every item. How the repair has to be carried out, with what the repair has to be carried out, what is the grade of the spare, what is the grade of the material, everything has been defined as far as the IICL is concerned. Okay, that is what is there. It is also the approved continuous safety, the international agreement for maintaining containers in safe condition, the ACEP, that is the approved continuous examination program of the harmonized interpretation of the container safe, let's say, convention in the International Maritime Organization. Everything has been encompassed, and because of the IICL, it has been possible. I wouldn't go more into this one. It's a topic by itself. Okay, we need a full 1.5 hours, let's say, lecture on this one. So a lot of things are there. It becomes a part of the container leasing subject. Fine. But the entire maintenance and repairs, just to summarize, the entire maintenance repairs of the containers, and they were the, let's say, main people who got the convention on safe containers into place. MTD means a multimodal transport document. Okay, the multimodal transport document is issued by only, can be issued by only a registered MTO, that is a multimodal transport operator. Fine. Sure. Thanks a lot. Yes. CCI. Not Cricket Club of India for sure. Huh? What does it stand for?
Competition Commission of India.
Competition Commission of India. Okay. It is like the EU Commission. Competition Commission of India is already set up in India. Okay. It monitors all the, let's say, activities by the major corporates, that nobody indulges in cartelization. For example, a bid comes up to build a bridge. All of a sudden, you find only one company coming forward and putting the bid, and the rest, all the people, have actually quoted less. And eventually it is found out that both of them have discussed. You have put a bid, both of us have come up saying, okay, fine, do one thing. We will bid for this business. Whatever profit I make, I will share it with you. But you bid lesser than me. What happens? We have actually formed a cartel. Or sometimes when the bid comes up, both of us will say, okay, we will not quote, both of us, we will not quote below 100 rupees. What is happening? Now all of us will quote only 100 rupees. All four of us have formed a cartel and we have quoted. This is what is called as anti-competition. They have set up a commission in India which is called as Competition Commission of India. They monitor each and every activities of all the corporates, whether it is the shipping lines, whether it is the telecom companies, and everybody. Tomorrow, today you are so dependent. I will take an example of Vodafone and Airtel, for example. If Airtel, Vodafone, Idea joins hands, okay, and Reliance, let's say, join hands and say that from tomorrow onwards, the outgoing call will be 5 rupees, incoming call will be 5 rupees. You guys are so hooked on to internet. You are so hooked on to your mobile phones. Today, you get out of the house, I've reached the station. I've reached the office. For each and everything, you have got a reporting, whether it is on WhatsApp or wherever it is. Go to the airport, I'm at the airport. Traveling to so-and-so place. Status. So you are actually you can say you are very much dependent on these communication means. So when you talk about dependency, the telecom companies could get into, I'm just giving you an example, they could come up and they could jack up the rates. What is going to happen? You will be paying that money, right? But is it competitive? No, it is not competitive. Definitely the Competition Commission of India has got the rights to go and investigate this case, whether any cartelization was formed, and if they find out, if they walk into an office, they can enter anywhere. And when I say anywhere, I am talking about your PCs, your mobile phone records, each and every damn thing that you have. For the past 2 years or 3 years, they can go through all records, and if they find out anything related to that you have been instrumental in forming a cartelization, and they will fine you straight away, whether it is the FMC or whether it is the Competition Commission of India. In Europe, they have the European anti-competition law, which is there. In India also the same thing is there. European Anti-Competition Commission is also there. In terms of shipping, like Vodafone, Airtel, Idea and Reliance tried to jack up the price to 5 rupees outgoing, 5 rupees incoming. I will tell you it is 5,000, let's say, dollars for exports, $5,000 for imports for a 20-footer. What are you going to do? This is something that the competition law, and one or two complaint goes to the anti-competition, to the Competition Commission of India. They will probe that matter, and the fines are in millions of dollars. Kunanagal and DHL recently, they were fined. Kunanagal was fined for doing a cartelization. Straight away, $2 million, $3 million fines if you go into the various, A lot of freight forwarders have been getting into this cartelization and getting penalized in a big way. So it's very strong. You have to be very, very careful. In fact, most of the big shipping companies today, when you join, you have to sign a declaration saying that I will not get involved in any anti-competition activities, and the company will not be responsible if I am, caught in anything. The company has to have that declaration from you before you are getting employed. If you are employed, most of the European carriers have got this rule. So if you go to Maersk, if you go to CMA, if you go to MSC, you ask anybody, they will say, yes, I have given this declaration to the company. Because the company doesn't want to get responsible for any acts of yours. Fine?
Yes.
Chalo. Thanks.
Thank you.